This is Chemical Processes for Micro and Nano Fabrication. I'm Chris Mackin. We're at lecture 37, the last part four of our series on etch, our reading chapter 11 of our textbook by Campbell. Let's talk a little bit about the chemistry of etch processes. We've mentioned this a few times in passing in the previous three lectures, but there's some interesting aspects about plasma etch chemistry that might be a little not necessarily obvious at first glance. Let's look at a typical plasma. You have a gas, and you excite that gas with some RF energy and maybe some DC energy as well, some other approaches. But in general, most of the molecules are unaffected. So the neutral molecules that have not been changed might have a density of 10 to the 16th per cubic centimeter, let's say, at a particular pressure, just some typical number. Free radicals are by far the biggest reactive species that comes out of this plasma. The electrons smashing into various components produce a lot of free radicals, maybe 10 to the 14th per cubic centimeter. The ions, both electrons and positive ions, are generated in equal number. The ions are only something like 10 to the 8th per cubic centimeter. Much lower concentration of ions than free radicals. In fact, a million times lower concentrations. The radicals form more easily, and they have a much longer lifetime. Ions don't have a long lifetime. They disappear quickly, either because they're accelerated out of the plasma or they find another electron and recombine. But the free radicals last a long time until they react chemically. So there's a lot more free radicals, and that's why they tend to dominate the etch chemistry. When you think about etching, whether it's plasma etching or reactive ion etching, it's the radicals that produce the chemistry, and then ions add energy. There's some slow step, as we mentioned last time, some slow step in the etch process that the ion is able to add enough energy to make it go. And it's the speeding up of some slow step in the mechanism that enables reactive ion etching to work. But it's the free radicals that provide the chemistry. Let's take a look at some examples. Silicon etch. Silicon is often etched with carbon tetrafluoride, CF4. This is an inert gas. It doesn't react with much of anything. It's, in fact, Freon 14. But if we slam an electron into a molecule of Freon 14, we can produce lots of things. In particular, though, we produce fluorine radicals. A couple of ways. Dissociative ionization, electron hits CF4, and we get an ion of CF3 and a free radical of fluorine, and then two electrons. In impact dissociation, the electron smashes into the CF4, produces a CF3 and an F, and the electron bounces off. So I have two free radicals, a CF3 free radical and a fluorine free radical. It's the fluorine free radicals that then chemically react with silicon. So the fluorine will go in and break silicon-silicon bonds, and once enough of these bonds have been broken, we can get four fluorines associated with each silicon, and it becomes a volatile gas that goes out, and that's how the etching proceeds. Now, this bottom reaction is not a mechanism. There's actually a lot of intermediate steps. First one bond is broken, then another, and then another. Multiple fluorines combine, a lot of intermediates, but the end result is the formation of a volatile gas that enables the etching. Let's look at some basic etch chemistries all around. Polysilicon is, like silicon, is etched in CF4. We add some O2 though, in general, that allows us to get some selectivity with respect to silicon dioxide. We can add some H2 if we want some polymerization to occur to get that sidewall passivation that we like. But we can also use HBr or Cl2. the freons, we're trying to avoid using them because of their environmental impact. So we also see some of these other halides being used for that reason. SiO2, if we're on top of silicon, then we might use CF4 with H2. We don't put any oxygen in when we're trying to etch the SiO2. Notice how similar these two chemistries are by just changing how much H2 versus how much O2 is in the plasma. We can make it either etch silicon and stop on SiO2, or etch SiO2 and stop on silicon. Or if we're on top of silicon nitride, we have to use a different etch chemistry. So the etch stop layer matters a lot as to what etch chemistry we have to use. Aluminum, we use chlorine. We can't use fluorine since AlF3 is not volatile. So we tend to use chlorine chemistry for etching aluminum. And for photoresist, we etch with O2. We sometimes call this ashing the photoresist because oxygen essentially is required to burn the photoresist. O2 is great for etching all organics, and we sometimes use it for cleaning as well. Create ozone and clean off any potential organic contaminants that might be on the wafer. There are a number of issues or problems or difficulties with dry etching. I'll talk just about a few of them. One of them is called trenching. If we're etching some region, say a film in this region, occasionally ions will bounce off the sidewalls. The result will be a higher concentration of ions in a region right near the sidewall, because most of these ions are going essentially vertically, but not exactly vertically. So we'll get a higher ion flux in this little region right next to the sidewall. The result is a trench. And this can be a problem, especially if you don't have good selectivity with respect to the substrate or the etch stop layer. Charging. I start bombarding my system with ions. I can get charging. Depending on the conditions in the plasma, insulators in particular can be charged either positive or negative. Conducting species, like the silicon wafer itself, will conduct the charge out in and into the substrate. But things like into the wafer holder. But the resist is an insulator. It doesn't conduct charge very well, so it tends to build up charge. Again, depending on the plasma conditions, I might get a positive or a negative charge. Suppose I had a negative charge building up on the resist. What does that mean? That means positive ions will be drawn to the negative charge. So I might have some positive ion when moving straight down, coming past these negative charges and bending its path. The bending of the path, the attraction of this negative charge along the resist, will bring a higher flux of ions to the film near the resist, which gives an undercut to that film etching. Now, if I had the opposite, a different plasma voltages, etc., I might have a buildup of positive charges on the resist. That would tend to push away any positive ions that are being accelerated down towards the wafer, and the result will be the opposite of this undercutting. We get some footing. So either one of these cases can result in some non-ideal profiles of the etched material. Some other problems, we've already talked about ion damage to the lattice. Once we've stopped etching, we could still bombard the substrate, the etch stop layer, with ions, and they can actually damage the structure of that layer, in particular if it's the silicon surface itself. Polymerization, we saw, was an important mechanism that we can use for sidewall passivation and get more steep profiles. But we have to make sure that all of the polymer that's being produced that's not on the sidewalls, that's on the bottom of the etched surface, is fully removed. If any polymer remains, it could cause some problems with the characteristics of the etched surface. And then we have the topic of etch loading. This is an interesting one. You'd think if I needed to etch a 200 nanometer thick film of silicon dioxide, that I could find some process for a given mask and a given etch stop layer, find some process that would etch at a certain rate, and therefore I could etch it in a certain time to get rid of that 200 nanometers of silicon dioxide. But there's a phenomenon called loading. That means the etch rate depends on what percentage of the wafer is open to being etched versus the percentage of the wafer that's covered up with the mask material so that that's not being etched. If I have, say, 80% of the wafer that's not covered by the mask, that's going to be etched away, I can get some depletion of the reactants compared to, say, a situation where only 10% of the surface of the wafer is being etched. The result is called a macro loading phenomenon, where the etch rate depends on the percentage of the wafer that's masked by photoresist. And that depends on, well, the design of the chip that we're building. So now it's not just a function of how thick the layer is that I'm trying to etch away, but in fact it can change, these etch rates can change depending on the circuit design, which is an unpleasant thing to think about. Especially if we're in a manufacturing environment where we're constantly changing our circuit designs, like in a foundry environment. Now that's the macro loading, but there's also a micro loading phenomenon where it's not just an overall depletion of reactants, but I can get a depletion of reactants in one hole. Let me show you an example. Here's something I found on the web that shows some etched trenches, pretty deep etches, but here we have big trenches, 50 microns wide, going all the way down to 2 microns wide. And look at the interesting thing, that the 50 micron wide features etch to a depth that's quite a bit, almost twice as deep as the 2 micron wide features. Why is that? Well, there's a mass transport phenomenon going on here. If I have a very narrow hole that's very deep, it can take longer for the reactants to make it down to the bottom of that hole and to actually perform the etching. Also, there's shadowing. I don't have perfectly vertical directions for my ions. I have a small range of angles. And that small range of angles, once I get to a fairly high aspect ratio of the feature being printed, can make a difference in terms of the etch rate. This is called microloading, where some features etch differently than other features. In particular, if I have an isolated hole, if I have a small hole versus, say, a post that's being etched, that hole will generally etch more slowly than the material surrounding that post. And the result will be we'll get the wrong feature sizes compared to what we were looking for. One of the ways of dealing with macro loading in particular is to use endpoint detection. So we would like to know ahead of time how long we have to etch a particular wafer. If I have a known thickness and a known process. But if the etch rate depends on, say, the design of the chip because of the percentage of the area of the wafer that's being etched, I might not know ahead of time how long I have to etch. Also, this etch rate can be somewhat variable depending on the conditions of the chamber itself. You know, the etch chamber will actually change with time because of coatings and etchings of the chamber itself. As a result, we'll sometimes try to use endpoint detection to know when the etching is complete. How do we do that? There's a couple of ways. One is we can measure the thickness of the film that we're trying to etch away in real time. We use some optical technique like interferometry. This tends to work on transparent films like silicon dioxide or silicon nitride, not as well on many metal films. And it requires us to have a big open area that's being etched that I can measure. Another approach is to look at the plasma. Remember that the plasma glows with lots of colors. Well, what are those colors? They're nothing more than the electronic transitions of excited state electrons falling back to lower energy states. And the specific wavelengths emitted by those atoms varies as a function of the specific atom or molecule. It produces a spectrum. It's kind of like flame spectroscopy. We can identify the species based on the wavelengths of the emitted lines. So we simply take some of the light coming out of this plasma, send it through a spectrograph that divides it up by different wavelengths, and look at the intensity as a function of wavelengths. We find peaks that we recognize as being silicon or aluminum or nitrogen compounds, etc. So as it's etching, there's a lot of that film that's coming out into the plasma. As the gas flow goes, it's being swept away. And so we see a big peak for whatever the film is we're etching. But once we've reached the bottom, that peak disappears. Now we start etching the etch stop layer. And we start seeing signs of whatever material that etch stop layer might be showing up in the spectrum for the plasma. And that gives us an indication that we've reached the bottom and we're now starting to etch the etch stop layer. And therefore, an endpoint has been reached. So endpoint detection is I wouldn't necessarily call it common, but we use it quite a bit. One final topic I'd like to mention. Etching can produce some really remarkable structures. And one of the most interesting things we see, not so much in semiconductor manufacturing, but in other areas of microfabrication like MEMS manufacturing, but sometimes we're starting to see even in semiconductor manufacturing, we have a need to etch very deep holes, very deep structures. And that can be hard to do, as we saw before, because of the difficulty in getting materials down into a very narrow, deep hole. But also, these etch rates tend to get very, very slow as you go down and down into the hole. So I can take a really, really long time, and sometimes we have to move a lot faster in our etching. One process that enables etching of very deep structures is called the Bosch process. And this process is a common technique for doing deep etches. We alternate between two different processes. First, we'll etch, say, silicon with SF6, a mostly isotropic plasma etching process. Then we'll quickly throw in some gases that allow us to generate polymers, and we'll passivate the sidewall. So we begin an etch, then we passivate everything with polymer, and that. Then we'll start etching again. We'll get some sputtering that takes away the passivation at the bottom, but not on the sides, and then we alternate. We go over and over and over again, this quickly back and forth between etching chemistry and passivation chemistry. The result is we keep passivating the sidewalls and we can push down to very, very deep structures. We get this characteristic scalloping on the sidewalls, but we can actually figure out ways to do similar kinds of processes without the scalloping. And we can get very, very deep reactive ion etching. DRIE, or dry processes, they're sometimes called. DRI. Anyways, I thought that's just a fascinating topic to throw in at the very end of our discussion about etch. So let's look at what we've learned in our last lecture on etch. Why are free radicals more likely to be involved in etch chemistry than ions? Describe trenching and its cause. Describe charging and what its effects can be. Define macroloading and microloading. Why might we be interested in using endpoint detection? And finally, what is the Bosch process? How does it work? And what is it used for? Well, that's our final lecture on etch. Next time, we'll begin a long discussion about my favorite topic in semiconductor manufacturing, lithography. Till then.